things like that. That's how you're going to get the most out of your chemistry. As soon as you open that lid to that can, you're open to a world of variables that only you can control. Any spray operation, whether it's a fungicide or a herbicide, is always a compromise. We've got this little Venn diagram here. You can see, obviously, we want to be at the top part for efficacy, but that might be compromised in terms of the weather. Spray patterns, you've got drift. You don't want your herbicides drifting onto a neighbouring veg crop, for instance, things like that. So we've always got to have a compromise between efficacy, workloads, and the environment. So the landscape is changing in terms of certainly for pre-emergence herbicides, but also post-emergence. And we've obviously seen that with new labels coming through with drift reduction technology stipulated on the label. Previously, it has all been about efficacy, but as units have got bigger and bigger, workloads have increased, and we're getting more and more compromised, and we're getting cases of increased drift. Product drift, there's two things there. Obviously, you have a reduction in efficacy. If you're having 20% drift, that's 20% of your spray bottle drifting off and not controlling the target. But then there's also a risk to contaminating non-target areas, and there's obviously the environmental side of things, if you're going to water courses, etc., and the public perception. You only have to look at the glyphosate campaign to see, you know, the public perception of our sprays and how that's affected our industry. And obviously the crop protection industry is coming under more and more pressure in terms of regulatory point of view. John, could you play that video, please? This is just an example of some poor application practice.
Will that be a...
Yeah, if you just click it here and there. So you can see there, this is a farmer spraying on a day where there's absolutely no wind. And you can see that's quite, so it's not that clear on the screen, but that spray solution is just sitting on the top of the surface and will end up drifting off to that hedgerow in the background rather than staying on the target. And that's kind of things that we don't want to see. Obviously, the spray driver thinks, oh, there's no wind, perfect. Actually, it's the wrong thing to do. And we should really be looking at that force two wind. Okay, so that's our optimum kind of operating parameters. As you increase the wind, you double your drift, basically. So if you follow the blue line there, you can see we've got 15 units of drift. If you double that wind speed, all of a sudden you're getting 14. So that spray solution is just drifting off, it's not hitting the target. It's really, really important that we take into account wind and the environment. And then forward speed is another thing. I think there's too many people going too fast to try and increase their work rate. And that is increasing drift. And you can see the two pictures there. You know, same sprayer, same day, same field, two different speeds. And you can see the drift coming off on that right-hand picture. And that's not good. That's what the public see. And they perceive that as poison, and all the farms are poisoning us. Obviously, with forward speed comes boom control. So the slower you go, the more stable your boom is going to be. It's really, really important to get that speed right down. So we're talking 10 to 12 k's an hour. I don't really want to see people going more than 12 k's an hour, especially when it comes to herbicide applications. And again, boom height is another one. Appreciate some guys might not be able to get down to 50 centimetres, but get as low as you physically can. If you can't get to 50, slow down even more would be my advice. Okay, and you can see here, so again, if you take the red line, 50 centimetres on the left-hand side there, you've got one unit of drift. As you go up to a metre, all of a sudden you've got 10 times the amount of drift. Okay, so that's 10 times the amount of product that's not ending where it should be. And there you can see it again on boom height, just the difference between the two and the amount of drift that's coming off there. It's really, really important that we control drift to keep a hold of our products that we've got, never mind getting new ones. And then, obviously, pressure is another thing. I would say if someone's operating at 3.5 bar with a flat fan nozzle or an angled nozzle, you really need to be choosing a bigger nozzle orifice and bringing your pressure back down to 2 bar. Okay? And there are some low drift nozzles out there that can produce a fine drop, that, and we're getting good efficacy with that, and we have seen that in the summer. In terms of what we're doing going forward, we're looking at a range of different nozzles. You can see that there's a plethora of them out there. Some flat fans, some angled, and some of these low drift nozzles. to see how we can better get better efficacy from these new modern-day 90% drift reduction nozzles. So we did a test down in Stein, so looking at black grass seedlings and looking at the deposition that these nozzles give. There's another video here, John, if you could just click the screen. Yeah. This is an example of a track sprayer at Stein, and this is how we test. Okay, so this is a little example of what we're doing over at Stein, at one of our research facilities. And we can see there, so basically we've taken all those samples, we've analysed the seedlings, but what we've also done is put metal rods in there as well, so we can measure deposition on there. And what we do is we put it under a UV light. So you can see there in the bottom left-hand corner, those are the tissue samples, and we can see there that we've got some trace of herbicide deposits on them. And again, so under the UV light, we can see there. The problem with this is that we're also getting fluorescence from the coleoptile, which means we can't get an accurate measurement. Okay, so what we've had to do is then take these metal rods, put them under UV light to give us an accurate measure of the spray deposit from each of the various nozzles. What we can see on here is actually on that right hand side, that's where you want to be. So you've got a 3D nozzle, that's giving you the best deposition. So nice angled forward and backwards, you're going to get the best deposition. But actually, some of these low drift nozzles, the IDKT and the IDTA, they're actually giving us very, very good deposition. And there's always been, I think, in the past, 90% drift reduction nozzles don't give you the efficacy you want. But we can actually see from this trial, the trials we've done on black grass trials, that we are actually getting very, very good control from 90% drift reduction nozzles. I think they've come a very long way in the last couple of years, and it's certainly something we should be looking towards, using these nozzles in compromised situations. And then looking at influence of spray volume, very busy chart, but what it's basically saying is there wasn't that much difference between 100 and 200 litres of water. But what we are seeing is that post-M, when you go to 200 litres of water, you are creating runoff, so you get less deposition. Post-M, we would still say 100 litres of water, but pre-M, you're after coverage. And that's really important to up your water volumes to the 200 litres of water. So in conclusion, basically, I think the first thing in terms of your weed control is get your seed bed right. That's the most important thing. You know, you don't want too many big clots for those weeds to emerge from. Ideal spray conditions, carry on with the angled nozzle, like the 3D nozzle. And then if you are in a compromised situation, which probably 9 times out of 10 we are, then we need to be headed towards those 90% drift reduction nozzles. Okay, we've seen over in Holland where they have to use a 90% drift reduction nozzle, an increase in them not finding residues on non-target crops. It went, I think, from 38% down to 0% just through using new nozzle technology. And then obviously pre-M applications, 200 litres of water, post-M 100, our advice remains the same on that. And we are doing more work specifically on maize over in Belgium, because they are under significant pressure in terms of their chemistry and the environment and ending up in water and non-target crops. So that's it from me. I know it's a quick whistle stop. Feel free to, you know, come and see us in the breaks.